Right, okay. Hello, everyone. It's 5 minutes past six. So I think we should get going, as it were. What I should do is share with you the LMS website, since it's an LMS meeting. And you can see, there's a bit of news there. Alan Turing on the £50 banknotes. A good bit of news there. Part of the actual design of it is from an LMS paper that Alan Turing wrote. So there's a bit, if you look at the paper on there, on the £50 note. But anyway, so this is a London Mathematical Society meeting. I'm Dr. Kevin Houston. I'm the Education Secretary of the London Math Society. So I'll probably say a bit about the LMS at the end. But for the moment, I want to just get on with the meeting as it was, as it were. So thank you very much for attending. What we're doing today is we'll have the microphones muted and the videos turned off. So if you want to ask a question then or make a comment, then please put it in the chat, and we'll have say about 50 minutes. The lectures will last for about 50 minutes, and then we'll have 10 minutes of questions, and I'll just basically wrangle the questions. I'll see what people have written in the chat. Just so that we can keep to time, as it were, because it takes time to ask people to unmute and then they make sure they're unmuted and all that. So, but you maybe, if you put a question in the chat, then your name will be able to, you'll be able to view, people will be able to view your name. So if you want to become anonymous, you can change your name. You're able to rename yourself on this system if you don't want it. The lectures are being recorded, but as you're not being able to turn on your mics and videos, that shouldn't be a problem about being recorded, but the name might appear somewhere. Okay, so if we're kind of, I want to stop sharing. So I want to introduce our first speaker today, and that's Aoife Hunt. So Aoife studied maths at the University of Greenwich and received a PhD in fire evacuation modelling. She spent time as a senior lecturer before taking a research experience into industry in simulating the dynamics of people movement to a wide range of projects. So Aoife is currently associate director at GHD in a team called Movement Strategies and leads on movement projects worldwide. So that's including Wembley Stadium, the Eiffel Tower, Wimbledon, the Olympics, and the Tower of London. So during the pandemic, Aoife has led a targeted effort to provide a new and innovative technology solution to help with the challenges of social distancing, providing a conceptual approach to quantifying social distancing rules within the context of spatial engineering, effectively stating what was the maths behind social distancing and what impact this would have on the use of space. So I think it's something we can all get into there. So, Aoife also volunteers for outreach events to wider participation and diversity in maths and STEM subjects, giving talks and workshops for school children and particularly girls. She has delivered these events for schools and universities across the country and has appeared in various media, including the Irish Times, BBC and RTE Radio. So Aoife will now present the first lecture. So Aoife, I don't know if you'd like to start sharing.
Yeah, sure, Kevin. Thank you for such a lovely introduction. Right, can we all see that?
I can see it, hopefully.
Wonderful. That's the important thing. Right, everyone, I'm keeping chat open at the same time, so I will be keeping a vague eye on the chat. So if you want to say anything as we go, please do feel free to chip in. But as Kevin has said, I'm here to talk with you today about the maths of crowd behaviour. But first, I'm going to start with a bit of an introduction to me. A bit of my background and my very strange job. So I'll start with an introduction to me, and this might be a bit of an obvious one, but the most important thing you need to know is that I love maths. It's one of my favourite things in the whole world. And this is really for those of you who are at school and deciding what to do. I'm just going to give you a bit of my sort of strange career journey to date. When I was a teenager, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I didn't know whether I'd go and be a teacher or an accountant or all sorts of different sort of professions that I was looking at. But I did know that I did want to do maths. It was the only subject that I consistently liked. I didn't like every part of it, and I still don't, but there are parts of it that I loved and I knew I wanted to continue it. So I went and studied maths at university, went to the University of Greenwich, this beautiful campus here in near the Thames in London. And again, during my degree, I thought, well, I'm not really sure what I want to do. I'm, you know, lots of options out there, lots of career talks, lots of interesting things to do. And just as I was trying to decide what I might do with my master's degree in my final year, the perfect job arose from nowhere. I don't know if you can see this on a small screen. This is Rachel Riley. But before Rachel Riley was hosting Countdown, Carol Vorderman was the host. And she was leaving right when I was in my final year. And I thought, that's it. That is the job for me, the job for a mathematician. And I did go for it. And I went for the auditions and I was down to the final five, but Rachel Riley actually beat me. Not bitter or anything. So there at the young age of 21-ish, I was a bit distraught, didn't know what I was gonna do, decided to give up on maths in university and everything, and shocked my parents by deciding to go touring in a rock band, which did not succeed, as you might be able to tell. And when I decided to go back to education, maths was always gonna be the thing that I was gonna do. So I ended up going to do a PhD, and back to the University of Greenwich. Here is the ridiculous hat that you get to wear if you go and do a PhD there. And this is a selfie taken with a worldwide expert, Professor Ed Gallier at the Fire Safety Engineering Group at the University of Greenwich. And as Kevin said, what I was looking at was evacuation modeling and the modeling of people movement, which is what we're going to talk about in a moment. And then finally, before I moved on to sort of my main career researching, I'm very proud to say that I won an award for this research. And this is really a shout out to all the women on the call. I was the first woman to win this particular award for my research. So at this point, I realized there's a world of opportunities in terms of jobs and, you know, particularly if you've got a maths qualification, there's a lot of stuff out there. But I decided to stick with what I'd grown to love, and this was the simulation modeling of people movement. And so I decided to go and work as a consultant. Now, for those of you who don't know what a consultant is, the advantage of going to be a consultant is you don't just work for one sort of client or company. You end up working for lots of different ones. And here's an example of the kind of clients that the company I work for work with. And something I'm sure you can see in common across all of these different names here is that these are all sorts of sites and events that deal with large crowds. Now, the subject of my studies, my research, but also my work has been really focused around this really particular area in mathematics called simulation modeling. And hopefully you can see a stuttery building, a video happening in the background of this. Simulation modeling is creating a physical environment, but in a digital way. So replicating physical, in this case, physical movement of people and a physical building environment. And then being able to use that as a computational test bed to test all sorts of stuff to do with how people move. Now, many of you think, this looks like a computer game, and to some degrees it is. It's like a computer game, but a bit smarter, almost like The Sims, where you can build an environment and populate it with people and sort of get them to do stuff. But this is a tool that's used all across various industries to help us understand the performance of things like buildings and other things. So, well, let's ask the sort of fundamental question here. Why would we want to do this? Why would anybody want to model crowds? Well, first and foremost, safety. So as I'm sure you can imagine, if there was significant levels of crowding in an area, or if there was an emergency, there could be risks of overcrowding and sort of crowd crush conditions. And so most of this sort of modeling process has been used in evacuation modeling. So looking at how quickly you might be able to get people out, how quickly they might be able to safely escape from a fire or from a sort of a flood or an attack scenario, all sorts of different reasons for modeling crowds. And the same for security purposes, but also Increasingly, there's the use of crowd models to make sure that the system of crowd movement in an event, as you can kind of imagine, leads to a positive experience, leads to an experience that people are going to enjoy. Now, this is a really practical area of maths. It's a very, very applied area. And for that reason, the kind of work that I do and the kind of questions that I ask are really practical questions. And I have some examples here of some sort of typical strange questions I get asked as part of the job. So for those of you who don't know what a mathematician tries to solve every day, here's a really good example. Practical questions. If I have a concert in my football stadium, how many people can I fit on the pitch? How long will it take to evacuate everybody? And is it safe for me to sell tickets to people that allow them to go between the seats and the pitch? So this was a question I was asked about a year ago, and we built a crowd model to answer those questions. Another one. I don't know how many people are going to come to my parade. It's definitely between 30,000 and 100,000. Where should I put my barriers, and how many security search points do I need? This may not sound like maths, but hopefully by the end of this presentation, you'll see how we can apply these modeling techniques to help answer them. A very glamorous one here. Where should I position my toilets so that they're visible and accessible to everyone? How many do I need to make sure nobody waits for more than 2 minutes? So here's a lovely optimization problem for those of you interested. But again, the glamorous subject of toilets is something we can't seem to escape in the world of crowd dynamics. A short one here. Should I spend 2 million on an extra lift? I was asked this, I think, 3 years ago-ish. A very simple questionnaire, you know, very short sentence, but it led to an enormous piece of research. How much slower will people walk in the US compared to China? So if we're planning different events, how could we take people's walking speed into account? And then most recently, what is the new capacity of an arena if everyone needs to be socially, physically distanced? So I hope you can see the extent of practical questions that could be asked and answered by this kind of work. And to answer these questions, we need a whole load of things. We need modelling, so we need the ability to test real life situations. We need data, particularly people movement data. And we need a theory. We need theory about how people act and move and respond. And so for that reason, even though this is an industry that's sort of growing, there's an awful lot of research still happening in this area. And as a company that we research with various institutes around the world. And for that reason, in order to answer any one of these questions, it's never purely maths question or a purely computer science question. You need a big multidisciplinary team. So of course, you need mathematicians, computer scientists, data scientists, but you also need psychologists, social scientists, criminologists, urban planners, engineers, logistics specialists, all sorts of people, lift engineers. And, you know, very lucky in our company, certainly to have a really diverse interdisciplinary team from across the world speaking all sorts of different languages with all sorts of backgrounds. And that is crucial to being able to address some of these problems. So that's an introduction to my very unique job, I think. And today's talk, we're going to be covering some of the crowd maths fundamentals. I can see some comments in the chat. So for example, is it linked to fluid dynamics? We've got some of that coming up. Is it linked to probability distribution functions? We've got some of that coming up too. We're going to be talking about the maths fundamentals, also some modeling techniques, and a bit about the latest research and data, because as Kevin said at the start, this is a live topic. This is not a solved area by any stretch of the imagination. And with social distancing and the pandemic, there's been a whole load of developments in this area. And the other thing I can promise, as I'm sure you can see from the practicality of this subject, lots and lots of applications. So I'm going to dive right in. Now, I've got a multiple choice question for you all. So I hope you're all awake. And I know that the chat's working because I can see some people in the chat already. But who walks quicker? This is going to be, apologies with the noise outside. This is going to be my first question for you all. First option is England football fans. Second option is going to be rugby league fans. The third option is Ed Sheeran fans. And the fourth option is Taylor Swift fans. So quickly, everyone, if I'm going to give you just 20 seconds, type in the chat. Who do you think, which crowd do you think is going to walk quicker? We've got a big bias here towards Taylor Swift and Ed Sheeran so far. And Kevin's shouting England. Okay. All right, everyone, thank you for putting that in the chat. And what I want you to do is to keep that in mind and keep your sort of reasoning for that in mind as we go through the rest of the talk. Okay, so we're going to start right at the beginning with what is a crowd? Now, this sounds like a simple question, but if you really think about it, it becomes a lot more nuanced than you might imagine. So we're going to think about two things first, a physical crowd and what we call a psychological crowd. A physical crowd, well, we know that an individual person, one person is a person, an individual. Then you've got a pair, that's two people. Then you've got three, a triad, a trio. And then if there's four, it's quad something or other. And then at some point, you get a crowd. And we know in between those stages, there's also lots and lots of groups and different sort of group sizes as well. So there's a lot of debate around what actually constitutes the crowd, but let's assume that at some point we all agree what a crowd is and it looks probably something like this. That's fairly straightforward. Now, a psychological crowd is really is a different thing. So a psychological crowd is normally defined by a group of people who are exhibiting collective behavior. So they're having the same experience as each other and they're exhibiting the same sort of behaviors as each other. They share goals, they share expectations, and the fact that they're in a crowd together, a psychological crowd together, will impact the behavior as a physical crowd. And the interesting thing with psychological crowds is we can belong to multiple collectives at once. So we're all in a crowd here, lecture attendees, and then some of us are LMS members. And that's another sort of group that we may or may not be part of. There, we could be in a group called Arsenal supporters. And I know James Maynard, who's speaking after me, for example, is a big Arsenal fan. Or indeed, based on the chat, Taylor Swift fans. Now, you could be any one of these or none of these, or certainly all of them. I'm going to bet that James is, in fact, all of these. And the interesting thing is that the number of the crowds that we belong to will impact the way that we behave around certain people. And what I mean by that is how closely we'll stand with them, how quickly we'll walk, how motivated we are, how disorderly we'll be collectively. So in conclusion, the answer to what is a crowd is actually really complicated. And what do we do in life when something's really complicated? We tend to just do the bit we can do, the easy bit. And in crowd science, the bit that we can do is the physical aspects, the physical movement of people. So historically, up until very recently, the way that we thought about crowds and the way that we measured them was really focused on the physical aspects. So I'm going to show you some of this math that has been developed to deal with it. So a simple concept here is the flow of people when we're looking at a physical crowd. So that's the number of people who can pass by over time. And if we consider the flow of people, we can quite easily build some simple models about how people might move. And the first models were called ball bearing models of movement. So imagine, I'm not sure why they chose ball bearings, it could have been anything, but you're trying to tip ball bearings into a holder. And they're going through one by one or two by two. And if there's a rate that they can fall in. And that's how people were considered. And so evacuation analysis, looking at how quickly people might be able to evacuate, was using this sort of principle. So you've got a room here with a door, and there's a number of people in that room. And the door's got a certain width, so that's your opening. And then there's a flow rate of people that can go through that door, so the number of people who can pass through the door over time. And therefore, you can calculate the evacuation time of everyone is the number of people divided by the flow rate times the width. So you've got a flow rate over a certain area over a certain width, and then as the width doubles, the flow rate doubles, etc. It gets bigger. This could become more sophisticated by, for example, adding the time taken to walk to the door. But that's basically as complicated as this model can get. And the earliest models of how people, how quickly people are able to evacuate were based on this sort of calculation. And then, of course, it was applied in computer modelling. And this is one of the earliest computer models, nothing like the snazzy stadium one I showed at the start. This, believe it or not, is an evacuation model. These are all rooms connected by corridors, and people are moving from the right over to the left, and it's being categorized by the numbers of people dropping, the occupancy in those rooms dropping. And each of those arcs, the way that it's connected, has a capacity. And if you run that, it should tell you how quickly that number of people will exit. These aren't capacity numbers just here, these one ones, these are binary expressions of the network, but I'm sure you can see what the concept is. And then this became a bit more sophisticated over time. So you could look at a stadium, for example, and on the left-hand side here, you could say the width of every link on the network, and then compare it with the number of people on the network, the demand and the flow, and then you can figure out whether there's enough capacity for the demand. So these kind of models have been used for sort of mathematically for years now in terms of understanding people movement and how quickly people might be able to pass by. But of course, the key thing here is the numbers that you choose to put in with any model, right? So we might define flow in a certain way, but understanding those rates are really, really important. And so there are some key bits of data that we need. For example, how quickly people walk. And what we've learned is that how quickly people walk is related to how closely packed they are together. So there's a relationship between speed and flow that I've shown you recently, and also between speed and what we're going to call density. Now, density is the number of people per meter squared. So if you imagine a meter squared, what it would be like if you're sharing that meter squared with another person, that'd be two of you in a meter squared. If there were three of you in it, if there were four of you in it, etc. And what you can see here, this, by the way, is all of the data that's been collected on people movement speed since 1985. So it's considered the most modern data set, and it represents many, many, many hundreds of studies. And what you can see is there's a clear relationship between speed and density, because even if you as an individual are very, very quick, if you're put into a high crowded environment, you're going to be moving much more slowly. So there's a relationship between how quickly you can get out, for example, in evacuation, and how dense the crowd is that you're operating in. And some of these, I'm sure you can see, some of these densities are extraordinarily high, and they're from conditions, for example, at the Hajj, where you would find really, really high levels of density. And what you'll see in those conditions is the speed essentially drops to zero. Because people can't move at those density conditions. So let's have a look at this concept of flow, and just reminding you here that flow is the number of people over time. I'm going to give you a couple of examples here, and I hope you can see my videos playing on the screen. But here we have two corridors. One, well, it's the same corridor, it's just in two different times. So we've got a corridor here in the morning and in the afternoon. And what we're going to do is we're going to try and count the number of people as they are walking up this corridor in both of these time periods. And you see that red dotted line there? That's where we're going to count them. So let me show you what I mean. So on the left-hand side, we've got the morning number of people who are going through this corridor. This might be a sort of commuter route or something. And you can see there's not many people, and they're moving quite quickly, and we're going to count them through that line, and they're going to go through a door at the end. And then we're going to look at this again on the right hand side, and now you can see that there's much higher density in this corridor, and you get these kind of shock waves, as you also get in traffic and other sort of modeling, at a certain density, especially when there's a narrowing at the end. And so we can see that people are sort of queuing and stopping and starting. My question for you is the following. Which one do you think has the highest flow? So flow is the number of people over time. Do I have the equation? Yeah, I do. flow is the number of people over time. We're going to count them across these lines, and I'm just going to give you 15 seconds to have a think about it and put your answer in the chat. Which do you think is the highest flow, AM or PM? Lovely to see lots of people out there. Ma'am is an interesting answer. Okay, I'll let a few more come in. I hope you're all monitoring this at the same time. So we've had a range of AM and PM, lots of PMs and some people saying the same. Let's have a look at the data. So we've counted, well, we've got a computer to count the number of people crossing these lines over time, and here are the graphs. So this is just a count of people in a minute going through those lines. And on the left-hand side, you've got the AM graph, and on the right-hand side, you've got the PM graph. Sort of doesn't tell us very much. Maybe we'll take an average and have a look. What we'll see here is that the average is actually the same. It's 121 PPM is people per minute. 121 people every minute on average are going past those two points, which sort of seems counterintuitive because they're very different conditions and that we're dealing with very different numbers of people. And interestingly, and for those of you particularly who are at school or have just left school, the relationship between these are a formula that you should know really, really well, because we've got two different conditions producing the same answer. And that, of course, leads us to believe that maybe it's a quadratic, or this could be modelled by a quadratic. So what we have here is on the bottom density, so the number of people per square metre, if you remember from before. And on the left, on the y-axis, we've got the number of people who can pass per minute. And what you'll see is that 121 people can pass per minute when there's low density. And then also 121 people can pass every minute when there's high density. And this is actually the model that is used for fire engineering in buildings. So when they're looking at how many people can leave your offices, your school, your library, your sports hall, quadratic equations are used as a basis for that. And the interesting thing here is it means that you can improve your flow. If you look at the top part of this graph, you can achieve a much, much higher flow should you be able to keep your density levels to about 2 people per meter squared. There's lots of research happening in this area at the moment, and it's always fun doing crowd movement research, packing people in and getting them all to escape to try and understand how long it takes. And for those of you who are really interested, don't be put off, those of you who aren't, by the equations coming up, but those of you who are interested, here are the real equations, the real quadratics that are used in fire engineering calculations, looking at the speed of people, the density, and what we call the effective width, as in we don't normally have that lovely perfect exit width at the end. There's normally lots of obstacles in the way, and so you have to take some sort of minimum design width. And the interesting thing is that this quadratic shape has been used to model this, not just in one single form, but it has been recalibrated for different things. So you might have one quadratic for a corridor, and another one for a stairway, depending on the configuration of that stairway. So that's the first bit of math that underpins all of this thinking about people movement. And I think what we're seeing here is that the density really matters. We saw that in the speed graph, we're seeing it here in the flow graph as well. And density is really important. Whether you're at 1 person per meter squared, this is kind of what it looks like, 2 people per meter squared, 3 people per meter squared, 4. It gets harder and harder to see the crowding, I think, when you get up to 5 or even 6 people per meter squared. But it's really important to know how many people are in a space to be able to work out all of these other equations, but also for safety purposes. So knowing whether people are in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 persons per meter squared can help us to understand whether there's any risk to safety. So here's some example outputs from a model, and the maps show, and you can see the colour scheme at the bottom there, the maps show the areas of different density types and where the density is getting, the pressure is building up. So density is really important, but it's very hard to understand how many people are in a particular area. And I'm going to ask you all again in the chat to answer the following multiple choice question, which is, how many people do you think are in this graphic? So another 20 seconds. Don't think about it. Please don't try and count it. There isn't time. Let's give it a go. Maybe Kevin will put the first one in. Okay, lovely. Lots of C's, D's. Some people have chosen 2,000. That's brilliant. Brilliantly high. 800 plus. Okay, thank you all. Okay, I did count this on one rainy day. And you know when you when you're counting something and you think, goodness me, I've definitely messed up here. I'm halfway through and I've definitely not counted the last 10. I also got my mum to count it. I think it's 857. She thinks it's 858, and you can believe whoever you want. But the answer here was E, or 800 plus. But I think what we saw from the answers is that there was a big range of answers there. There's something psychological going on here as well, because had I positioned the questions a little differently and put 800 as the C option and given you 2000 as the E option, for example, you would tend to get a normal distribution across all of the answers, with most people focusing in the middle. But anyway, the important thing here is it's really hard to understand how many people are in a place just by counting or looking. And as humans, we're really bad at big numbers. And most people would get these kind of counts wrong. And, you know, this is quite important for safety, but this is only 858 people. If you're talking about Glastonbury Festival and there's 175,000 people, being able to understand how many people is in an area is, you know, really, really important. So increasingly, people are using different sorts of data sources to try and understand that. And I'm sure, sorry, my point here was that humans are not objective. We're all influenced by the categories we're given. There are many other new data sources which have been developed to understand movement and behaviour, so including mobile phone networks, cameras, looking at where people are reporting they are from social media, Wi-Fi, all sorts of ways of counting numbers of people. And this has been used in all sorts of sports planning. So famously at the Olympics, it was used to see what routes people were taking to make sure that they were, to make sure that everything was evenly distributed. It can help us understand the journeys that people are taking. So the progression of cell phone pings off as people are traveling, either walking or on a train. So we have all this new big data, which has been gleaned by all this sort of modern technology. And that means for modeling, we've got all that old school data that I spoke about, which was the speed density relationships, the flow density relationships, but now we've got a lot more big data, and that can help us to underpin more sophisticated modeling. But we also need small data. We need small data on an individual or group kind of level, because the problem with some of those early models that I showed you, for example, the ball bearing models, is that it assumes everyone's the same, that everyone's the same shape and size, or all the same ball bearing, if you will. And it can be dangerous to assume that everyone is the same. So I'm gonna give you an introduction to some of the research that has been done to try and address this. And there was a big research project happened recently at Wembley Stadium. It was a partnership with Wembley Stadium, the FA and Quintain, as well as research institutes in Canada, Lund University, and the organisation that I work for. And a couple of master's students helped us to answer some questions around how quickly different people can move. And the data was, this is taken from a presentation at the Sports Ground Safety Authority conference, where we were explaining the research that was done and how it can impact planning. And what happened is we set up cameras around the site and had a look at people moving around. And we looked at four different events. Now, these choices might seem a little familiar from the start. We studied a football crowd, a rugby league crowd, an Ed Sheeran crowd, and a Taylor Swift crowd. And that meant that we could categorize all the different movements and behaviors of the different crowd types to help with planning. And we could answer some of the questions on everyone's lips, like who walks quicker? Now, does everyone remember? I hope you all remember your answers from the start. In reverse order, we have Ed Sheeran fans were the slowest, 1.5 meters per second, followed by rugby league fans, 1.6 meters per second. Then Taylor Swift fans, 1.64 meters per second. And for those of you who shouted England, and certainly Kevin Houston did at the start there, they were the quickest, 1.74 meters per second. Now, this does show a significant difference because there were a lot of different people counted. And it really is down to the different kinds of groups that you would see at these events. Ed Sheeran fans tended to be couples in sort of their 30s. The Taylor Swift fans were lots of teenagers. Lots of arm linking and lots of holding on to each other. Rugby league fans, it was the sort of in the middle of the day and there was quite a lot of alcohol on sale and people were moving quite slowly. And England football fans, I believe, were trying to get home very quickly because it was a later train. So for those who are asking questions in the chat, it was leaving. This was taken during egress. And in terms of the most variation, I'll refer you to the paper so that you can Google the paper which has been published on this. And the results can tell us, can help us to find patterns in these old relationships that we looked at. So flow and density and speed and density. And we can see some lovely patterns here. Now the density did not get up to very, very high levels that we saw this going down as we saw in that quadratic, but we do see it a little bit. But you will see clustering around low and high densities for the different events. So this is sort of some of the latest data that's been collected in this area. And it's important to take this large crowd data collection research forward and to continue doing it for new events. But it's also really important that we look at very specific small scale data collection, which doesn't seem quite so important, but actually is a really important part of modelling crowds. And what I mean by small data is things like decision delays. So if you're looking at evacuation, how long it will take people to evacuate, you want to know when they make the decision to evacuate, how quickly they decide to go. And there's a curve here, which is used as a probability distribution in modelling. Which can tell you the chance that someone delays for a certain amount of seconds. So for those of you at the start saying, could you use probability distributions to understand behavior? This is an example of one of those distributions. Another one is choice on escalator. So understanding how people make the choice to stand or walk, or indeed which escalator to choose. Timing things is really important, and this is other research that's unbelievably that's happening at the moment. How quickly will it take you to get dressed? So if there was an evacuation in a hotel or in, I don't know, a ferry where people are overnight and they're asleep, how long will it take for people to get dressed before they can then go and evacuate? Those kind of timings will really influence how quickly things can be done. And if you're looking at planning festivals at airports or other sort of crowded environments, then we go back to the glamour that we spoke about at the start, which is this idea of calculating toilet time. Now, you might not think this is sort of an important area of research, but there has been work done recently. I'm very proud to say that, that I was involved in the research that's been conducted in recent years around trying to time how long people will spend in the toilet. And when you publish an academic paper, you normally have to give it a very serious title, and we got away with calling it the toilet paper. So we looked at how long people spent in the toilet at an airport. And in terms of the distribution, it came out as a log normal distribution, which is what you would normally expect for this. Looking at the differences between male and female toilet users and those who are using the accessibility toilets. And you'll see over here some really, the mean is about 155 seconds all in all. But you can see up here some serious outliers where people were in there for a good 20 minutes. But again, the slightly less glamorous side of the research world here, but it does really, it is a really important part of crowd science. Now, I think I'm sort of running out of time, so I'm just going to zoom forward a couple of bits. Taking all of this into account and looking at behaviour means that having this sort of data and this sort of theory pumped behind the models, it means that we can find some powerful results and make some good decisions. What we have here is an evacuation model of a high-rise building. And now previously people were only able to use the stairs. So I'm hoping you can see sort of little amps going down these four stair columns here. But we can use simulation modeling to compare it with a case, for example, where people are allowed to use lifts. And we can replicate the choice to use lifts, how long it will take, all of those individual people's walking speeds, their demographics, their grouping, et cetera, et cetera. And we can look overall which one would be a more efficient system. And clearly the lift's going to be more efficient, but we can put a number to that. And finally, to move on to new challenges. So this was sort of a whistle-stop tour of some of the maths that goes into simulation modeling and the kind of work that I do. And of course, in the last year and a half, everything has changed. The space people require, for example, is different. Here we have, because of social distancing, whereas previously we occupied a certain amount of space, now if we want to distance from people, we require more space around us. And of course we can calculate the area required if you needed 2 meters, for example, around you in every direction. This meant that working out how many people can fit in a space became more of a circle packing problem. For those of you who've been studying maths and are aware of these, understanding capacities changed in this old school mathematical way of trying to maximize the space given to people. There's also, when people are seated, for example, and looking at social distancing, there's also a need to use some school level maths. For example, here we have the dimensions of a seat at a stadium, and in a stadium you only need to be a meter apart from someone. There's been an awful lot of Pythagoras used over the past year to work out how close people are going to be away from each other. So in this case, these two people on the right hand side, you'll see their circles marginally overlap. They're only 97 centimetres apart, which doesn't meet the 1 metre criteria. And so for those unfortunate stadiums who've got these seat dimensions, they had to seat people that much further away. And I'm sure you can imagine on a big scale what that meant for their capacity, having to move everyone one step away. And of course, other issues around what that means if people are in group sizes and how to optimize the seating layout became a really interesting optimization problem. And of course, modeling was brought into it as well. So simulation modeling was brought in to understand the differences. This is a very simple example with a corridor, but to be able to compare what happens with once you instigate social distancing. So the flow rate previously might've been 72, and now it would be more like 19 with social distancing. Right, I've definitely gone over time, so I'm gonna end there, and please shout if you have any questions.
Okay, thank you very much. I think some people might be able to have reactions. I don't know whether people can actually do that. And I don't know. I mean, it does seem as though some people can, not just me. Okay, right, thanks. Yes, people want to put some questions in the chat, and I think you'd answered some of the earlier ones. I was interested in the there was a picture I saw. What the pre-evacuation decision delay, and the bit about the quadratic that was used, you know, in this the football, the rugby league, and things like that. Can you show us that pre-evacuation decision delay?
Yeah, let me just pull it up again.
It might help when I'm asking my question. And people, and while I'm asking my question, people can stick questions in the chat. Yeah,
absolutely. Right. Tell me if I'm sharing my screen again. There we go. This one.
Yeah. I mean, so the start of that, the first bit, it goes up and it goes down. It looks like a quadratic, which is what we saw in the four groups marching along and leaving. So is this quadratic model very good then? I mean, because do you not have something that's similar to this picture here instead? I mean, how do you know that that's not the case? You see what I mean?
So firstly, they're two very different graphs. The quadratic is a model, which means that we assume after a certain density, it goes back down to zero. You're absolutely right. It doesn't go quite to zero and it tails off. And I think an important thing to realize here is that when we're modeling, we want to be conservative. We never want to plan for six people, seven people per meter squared. And for that reason, the model doesn't exactly replicate what happens at the other end. This is different because this is a probability distribution based on data, and this is the correct shape of it. It wouldn't be modeled as a quadratic because we use the probabilities at all of this for the full width of this diagram. There's no need to be conservative to chop it off. In fact, if we were being conservative, we would only use the later part of the diagram. So I think that's a question about modeling and when you choose to apply that data. But this has been really well established over years and years of research that this is the shape most of us will leave after about 60 seconds. So a fire alarm goes off, we all look at each other, we don't know what we're doing. Should we leave, should we not? We'd normally leave after 60 seconds, and then there's a whole bunch of people who will wait for a really long period of time. And that seems to be the case across countries and across cultures, and it's quite a well-established graph. But yeah, we'd definitely not apply this as a quadratic. It would not be the right model.
Oh yeah, for that one, yeah, wouldn't be. But you know, they kind of look similar to begin with. So, but anyway,
they are indeed, yeah.
So some people are starting to ask questions, and some people making comments like still gutted that Taylor Swift fans weren't the swiftest. So I'll go for the first question that I can see there. Does this relate to decision mathematics, bin packing algorithms and similar? I mean, so do you do a lot on that, thinking about those sorts of honeycomb packings and things that you mentioned?
As in the circle packing type stuff?
I presume so. Somebody's mentioning bin packing algorithms. I don't know.
That's not sure what a bin packing algorithm is. But certainly in terms of decision making, there's things to Google if you're interested in the decision making models that go underneath these. Well, Monte Carlo methods are used, so you can approximate people's decisions by putting a whole bunch of distributions in and saying these are the probabilities that people are going to do the following actions, and then run a simulation by repeatedly randomly sampling from those distributions. And also Markov chain methods are used to look at sequences of decision-making in the most complicated models. But as I said before, most of the models are focusing on the physical side of things because it's easier. I think we're gonna see much more on the decision-making side of things as we have increased computational power. Because as you can imagine, modeling 90,000 people leaving Wembley, individually thinking and making a decision every half a second is quite weighty. But as we get better at that, I think there'll be many more of those methods applied. So if that person is studying decision science and wants to come and join the field in 10 years time and fix all those models, please do.
A little job for them to do.
Yeah.
So I've got a couple of questions, and they're roughly the same. There's one from David and one from Nikki, and they're sort of like asking, have you considered simulations of things that aren't necessarily humans? And somebody's also asking about studying children as well. So do you do that sort of thing? A wide variety of things to study? And are they similar?
I think children are human, but that's... modeling humans is a bit different to modeling other things. Personally, I have modeled other things like traffic or in hospitals, the movement of beds or wheelchairs, which is slightly different to movement of people. But there's a whole world of modelling out there in terms of sort of traffic model or transport modelling, which looks at movement in a similar way. But there are big differences between them all. The big challenge we have at the moment is trying to tie together models. So if you can imagine, there might be a fire model, which is based on computational fluid dynamics and fire spreading across a building. And then we've also got an evacuation modeling model. And there's big challenges around pairing those two things together, because people would react if they're in a fire when they saw it. So there's a lot of modeling happening separately, and there's a real need in the future to pull them together.
Right. Okay. So some people are asking about sort of disasters in the past, whether you've looked into applying these models to those things, like the King's Cross tube fire and Hillsborough. I mean, do you study those or?
Yeah. So as part of my PhD, I looked a little bit at the World Trade Center disaster. It was one of the ways we all learned how to apply these models, and built a portion of the tower and looked at the evacuation. But I haven't personally applied it to King's Cross or to Hillsborough. But of course, there's been a lot of work since those disasters to try and understand what happened. And to my knowledge, models have been made of most of them to try and understand the sort of densities and experiences of people in that situation. And of course, looking for ways to make those things safer.
Right. Okay. Now, here's the most important question, I think, for anybody doing modelling is from Kushi. It says, how accurately do models reflect what happens in real life? What elements do you see in real life which you may not have predicted before in models?
So, excellent question. And we could do a whole other hour on that. And there's another one there about validation. Certainly in the fire safety community, there is a big push at the moment to have validation data sets which people can use to validate their models. At the moment, we go through a couple of exercises. One is verification, which is whether or not the model does the thing it says on the tin, and then validation, whether or not it replicates the scenarios of interest. It depends very heavily on whether you've got an equivalent data set with which to validate your model. So if it's a working stadium that's operational, what you can do is collect data at the stadium, use your model to predict what might happen, and then compare that against what did happen, and then calibrate to make sure you get as close as you can to reality, to give yourself a base model that then you could project forward with more confidence that the thing you're modeling correctly predicted a condition and therefore will be able to predict the next one. But with humans, it becomes very, very complicated, and people's behavior is obviously an enormous spectrum, and it depends on so many different things. So I would say that you can only really validate against somebody's physical principles, like how quickly can things be achieved and people, you know, leave, for example. You can't predict what any individual would do, particularly in an emergency. But you can test your extremes and say, well, in no way can we evacuate the stadium in less than half an hour. That's not acceptable. Let's go back and look at it. So it's in such a applied area. It's not about trying to get that perfect. It's impossible to get a perfect validation set, I would say. So it's about being practical.
Right. Okay. Good. Good. Let's see if I can, because some more questions have been coming in. So. There's a question from Alan here. Do you need to model well beyond a stadium? If so, how far? Because I mean, I presume that, you know, people will head towards places where they can travel from, like they'll be heading towards the underground station, and that has a big effect. And how far do you have to go beyond this? I mean, when you're collecting data,
very far. In a stadium, there's an area called Zone X, which is normally the stadium to the local transport hubs. You tend to model until the crowd has dispersed to such a degree that you can't differentiate them from pedestrians. They're no longer in a crowd moving together. But if you have a station near a stadium, it's imperative that you model the whole way to the station. And for those of you who've been at events, probably not recently, but for those of you who remember really crowded events, there's often crowd management at stations as well on major events. So understanding the conditions there, you can't just sort of stop a model and everyone floats off into the ether. You have to show that they're sort of taken care of on that part of the journey. And so for that reason, there's guidance, particularly in the UK, says that you should be tracking the safety of crowds to normally the nearest transport hub, but it's very dependent on the stadium. But for that reason, they're enormous models with enormous scale.
Right, indeed. And I think we've got enough time. I'll just ask this one because it sounds quite good. So from Andrew, it says, do any of the models of humans align with gas diffusion? I mean, can you pick gas diffusion has a very simple sort of mathematical description, doesn't it? I mean, do any of your models have this kind of similar sort of like simple thing in it, or is it much more complicated?
I think they're more complicated. I'd be surprised if someone hasn't applied it, but certainly the hydraulic models and the straightforward social force models, and I'm not aware of gas diffusion being used, but the more straightforward models that were applied have sort of been superseded by these more agent-based and individual-based models, I would say. But I may be wrong. There may be a gas diffusion model out there.
Right. So the models you're talking about earlier, so did you say Monte Carlo methods and things? Or
The more recent ones, yeah, the more sophisticated ones, yeah.
Want to look them up and get into them. Right. Okay. Thank you very much. That was a fantastic introduction to how maths gets used in a real life situation. So hopefully that's inspirational for people who, and perhaps some of the pupils who are in the audience. So can we once again thank Aoife? We can do this by doing the reactions. You can even do thumbs up as well. There you go.
Oh, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you for being such a lovely audience and for participating so well.
Okay, thank you. Right, so what we'll do now is we'll have a break until 15:15, and then we'll have our second talk with James Maynard. So put on a cup of tea or something, and or get away from the screen. I think is a very important thing to do, because it's not good just sitting looking at a screen. So at 15:15, exactly 15:15, be here and we'll start the next talk. Okay. Thank you. Right. I was about to say, it's time to come back. Time to start again. And I was going to say, we're going to start recording, but hopefully you're able to hear somebody saying, oh, this meeting's being recorded. So as I said earlier, if you don't want your name to appear anywhere, then please, change your name. I'll probably edit it out anyway if you don't do it in time. Anyhow, right, well, welcome back to the second lecture today. And I've got some notes on James Maynard here. So, okay, let's just head on in. Right, so I believe James is ready. He looks as though he's ready to go. Okay, so James Maynard was an undergraduate in Cambridge, then he got his PhD from Oxford under supervision of Roger Heath Brown. He then did postdoctoral work in Montreal, Oxford, Berkeley and Princeton as a CRM-ISM fellow, a junior research fellow and as a clay fellow. So, and since 2017, he has been a research professor at Oxford University. So he's been awarded several international prizes for his research accomplishments, including the 2014 Sastra Ramanujan Prize, a 2015 London Maths Society Whitehead Prize, a 2016 European Maths Society Prize, and 2019 Compositio Prize, and the 2020 American Mathematical Society Cole Prize. He was invited speaker at the 2008 ICM in Brazil. That's the International Congress of Mathematicians, which is like a massive, massive meeting of mathematicians. I think that one had was it 4,000 or so? Some really, really large number. and has been elected as a member of Academia Europaea. So James studies long-standing problems about prime numbers. He is naturally drawn to simple-to-state problems in pure mathematics, which have been unresolved for sometimes hundreds of years, despite the efforts of the most celebrated mathematicians in history. So James will now present the second lecture, Patterns in the Prime. So James, you'd like to start sharing your screen if needs be?
Yep, thank you very much for the introduction. So hello everyone, and welcome to my talk. So we're going to switch gears quite a lot now and go from the very applied side of mathematics to the very pure side of mathematics. So as you heard in the introduction, I'm a research mathematician who works in number theory, and this means that I spend most of my time doing very pure mathematical research about prime numbers. So often when I talk to people in the street, they find even the idea of a pure research mathematician somewhat strange. Often people feel like surely most problems in mathematics have been solved years and years ago. So part of this lecture is designed to be an introduction into the sorts of problems that I think about, and I hope to show you why I find these problems fascinating, and how actually in pure mathematics there's a huge number of still quite basic questions that we really don't understand. Often these problems have been studied for hundreds and hundreds of years, but they still have resisted the best efforts of mathematicians. But nonetheless, pure mathematics is a very lively and vibrant and growing field, and we are able to make progress even on these very difficult, famous 100-year-old problems. So, as I mentioned, I really am a number theorist, which means that I study the prime numbers. And so the basic question that I'd like to talk about today is sort of, why are the prime numbers interesting? That often prime numbers are associated with mathematicians in some way as if they're some geeky ply, but why should anyone care about prime numbers as these sort of abstract numbers? And essentially the tagline for my whole talk is that in mathematics, prime numbers are absolutely fundamental objects, and they're so fundamental, it means that they have applications across mathematics, but also outside in the real world as well. But somehow, despite being some of the most basic and fundamental objects in mathematics, they actually remain remarkably poorly understood. And so they really remain quite mysterious objects. And this is really why I find prime numbers such fascinating objects, because on the one hand, they're almost the most fundamental abstract building blocks of nature that you could imagine. But on the other hand, they're completely mysterious and poorly understood even today. So just as an outline, I want to start off by explaining what I mean by the prime numbers being fundamental and the way that they work as building blocks within mathematics. And then after this, I want to give you two examples about this sort of fundamental importance of prime numbers. So there's going to be examples on either end. One is going to be a totally applied example of the use of prime numbers in the real world. And then the second example is going to be demonstrating the importance of prime numbers for pure mathematicians and how prime numbers are fundamental for pure mathematics in and of itself. And then hopefully at the end, I'll be able to talk about how, even though several of the problems to do with prime numbers that have come up are famous 100-year-old problems that mathematicians have been stuck on for centuries, mathematics is not a dead subject in any shape or form. And even really quite recently, I and others have been able to make new progress on some of these old fundamental problems. But let's start off with prime numbers as building blocks. So So that we're all on the same page, let's just remind ourselves what prime numbers are. So a somewhat dry definition that if you looked in a maths textbook, it might say something like this. A prime number is a whole number which is bigger than one and can't be written as a times b for two smaller whole numbers a and b. So for example, 15 is not a prime number because although 15 is a whole number, it can be written as 3 times 5. However, 7 is a prime number. If you try and write 7 as one whole number times another whole number, the only ways you can do it is write 7 as 7 times 1 or 1 times 7, and therefore it can't be written as the product of two smaller whole numbers, A and B, because one of them has to be size 7. So if you first see this definition, I claim that there's one very obvious question that comes to mind, which is why on earth should you care about this? This looks like a completely artificial definition, which is maybe something that boring mathematicians might study, but it gives no indication at all as to why this concept of prime number should be of any use whatsoever. So, okay, you can come up with some logical puzzles based on some number, you've been able to write 15 as two smaller numbers multiplied together, but not being able to write 7 as two smaller numbers together. But that doesn't seem to be of any importance either within mathematics or outside in the real world. But the key reason that primes are fundamental, even though it's not obvious from that somewhat dry definition, is that they're really the building blocks of whole numbers under the operation of multiplication. So there's this completely general principle that underlies a huge amount of science, that scientists typically want to understand large, complicated objects. But this is a very difficult problem, but one of the most effective ways that we have of trying to understand large, complicated objects is to break down these big, complicated objects into much simpler building blocks. So for example, if you're a chemist, you're maybe interested in lots of the chemical properties of different chemical compounds. But as you've probably learned in school, every chemical compound is made up of atoms attached to one another, and the periodic table gives us a short list of different atoms that can possibly appear. And so by understanding just these atomic elements, these basic building blocks of chemistry, and how these different atoms can fit together, chemists are able to understand a lot about these very big, complicated chemical compounds, which if you just looked at them on their own, it would be exceptionally difficult to get any sort of easy classifications for these chemical compounds. So the basic building blocks of atomic elements give a huge amount of information about the overall structure of these chemical compounds. It's not necessarily the atomic elements that chemists care about, it's the chemical compounds, but they can get to understanding chemical compounds through these basic building blocks. And exactly the same thing happens in genetics as well. So a geneticist might be interested in genetic phenotypes. Say hair color is a genetic trait, and you can tell that some people have dark hair, some people have light hair, you have different hair colors. But it's very difficult to understand things if you only look at it on the level of hair color. But by understanding that hair color is determined at least partially by genes and the precise makeup of genes in terms of DNA base pairs, a geneticist can start to understand much more subtle properties about genetic traits through understanding genes and how genes are passed on and how mutations occur, for example, if say you're looking at viruses mutating. Recent topic. So again, in both cases here, we're interested in some fairly large, complicated objects, and we understand them by instead studying these much simpler building blocks. And the hope is if you can get a good understanding of the building blocks, you can start to build up a much better and clearer understanding of the complicated larger objects. So how does that work in mathematics? Well, I'm a number theorist, and I'm called a number theorist because roughly number theorists are people, are mathematicians, who want to study in some way the whole numbers. So these may be the simplest possible objects in mathematics, and the whole numbers, I just mean 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on, the numbers that you can count in your hand, and much larger numbers as well. And there's two absolutely fundamental mathematical properties that you can do with, two things that you can do with whole numbers. You can either add them together, or you can multiply them together. So there's somehow these two fundamental operations, addition and multiplication. And from the point of view of addition, whole numbers are just generated by the number one, that you get every whole number if you start with one and you keep on adding one. And that's almost how the whole numbers are even defined. And this means that actually many questions about the distribution of whole numbers are relatively simple because they have this rigid structure of being generated by adding one and adding one and adding one. If you take some question about the distribution of whole numbers, often you can reduce it down to essentially just a question about this operation of adding one, which is then quite easy to understand. There's just this one operation of adding one, and you can boil down a difficult problem into some fairly easy problem just about the number one. But when you look at the whole numbers under multiplication, suddenly things become much harder. And the reason that the prime numbers are fundamental important objects is because all whole numbers are generated by the prime numbers. So every number can be written as prime numbers multiplied together. And this means that because the prime numbers are somehow the atoms of arithmetic under multiplication, this means that if you have some complicated question about whole numbers which involves multiplication, you might hope to solve this difficult problem by boiling it down into a question just about the building blocks, and so just a question about prime numbers. But to understand and to be able to answer that question, you therefore need to understand various questions about the prime numbers and the distribution of prime numbers. So this is, I'll say it again, the real reason that prime numbers are important, and us mathematicians therefore call this a theorem, and we give it a fancy title. It's not just any old theorem, we call it the fundamental theorem of arithmetic. And this really dates back to the ancient Greeks. And this says that every whole number bigger than one can be written uniquely as prime numbers multiplied together, apart from the only way it's not unique is that you could reorder the numbers. So for example, 135 can be written as 5 × 3 × 3 × 3, and this is the only way that you can write 135 as prime numbers multiplied together. So therefore you can sort of think of 135 as if it's a chemical compound, and the atoms that make up 135 are the prime number 5 and 3 copies of the prime number 3. So this is some sort of visualization that I might think of 135 being broken down into its atomic parts, which turn out to all be prime numbers. And just because whole numbers are somehow the most basic and natural objects in the whole of mathematics, here's a quote from a famous mathematician called Kronecker, who said that God made the whole numbers, everything else in mathematics is just the work of man. Somehow the whole numbers are the most fundamental objects, but even whole numbers themselves can be broken down into these questions about prime numbers, which really makes prime numbers these fundamental atoms of the whole numbers when you're thinking about multiplication. So it's this fact that whole numbers can be broken down into their sort of atomic constituents of prime numbers, which means that prime numbers take on this very important significance within mathematics and are very useful. But the sort of crazy thing is that it turns out that even very simple questions about prime numbers remain very mysterious and poorly understood by mathematicians. It's somewhat embarrassing that we're trying to study just questions about the whole numbers and multiplying numbers together, and we can maybe reduce it down to a question about prime numbers, but despite these objects being sort of about as fundamental and as basic as you can possibly imagine, mathematicians still have a remarkably poor understanding about prime numbers, and so we can't really understand anything to do with the distribution of them rigorously very well at all. So I think this is nicely illustrated by a quote by another famous mathematician, Gonzague, who says, "Despite their simple definition and role as the building blocks of the natural numbers, the prime numbers grow like weeds amongst the natural numbers, seeming to obey no other law than that of chance, and nobody can predict where the next one will sprout." And it's this idea that somehow, on the one hand, prime numbers have a totally rigid, albeit dry, definition, and they're not random in any way at all. But on the other hand, they seem to look completely chaotic, and it's very difficult to predict them, that we often think about prime numbers as if they were random numbers in some way. And one other way to try and convince you that prime numbers really are these fundamental building blocks is, even if you don't care about mathematics too much, maybe you care about winning $1 million. So the Riemann hypothesis is sometimes dubbed the most important problem in the whole of mathematics. The Clay Mathematics Institute gives a $1 million reward if you solve the Riemann hypothesis. And very roughly, the Riemann hypothesis is a conjectural answer to the question of roughly how many primes are there which are less than some number x, where x can be a variable, but we're thinking of it as being some very large number. So is there some simple recipe that you can prove gives a very good approximation to the number of primes which are less than x, which holds for any possible value of x? So not just x being a million, which is a finite computation, but also x being a million, 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 something that computers would never be able to calculate. Can we still get a good guess as to the number of primes up to x? And the Riemann hypothesis is a very strong conjectural statement that would completely explain various aspects about the distribution of the primes and how many primes there are less than any given large number. So hopefully that gives you a vague feeling as to why I view the primes as important, that these are these fundamental building blocks or atoms of arithmetic. And it's not just me that finds prime numbers important. People are also willing to put money where their mouth is to try and get insight into these sort of basic questions about numbers under multiplication. But numbers under multiplication feels like this very abstract, pure mathematical world question that has no real connection maybe to the real world, to life as we live it in physics. So I'd like to try and convince you that actually in lots of different areas of real world life, we run into questions about whole numbers and multiplication, and this means that prime numbers are lurking just beneath the surface. So for this example, I'd like to imagine just buying something online. So I'm a mathematician, so maybe I do something boring, like look to buy number theory textbooks on Amazon. But I'm sure you can imagine rather more interesting things that you might want to buy online with your money. maybe Arsenal memorabilia or Taylor Swift albums, for example. But if you want to buy something online and you're going to use your credit card details online, it's certainly very important that your credit card details don't get hacked. It'd be pretty useless if I entered my credit card details to buy my maths textbook, but any hacker who was listening into the communication between me or my computer and the Amazon servers would be able to get my credit card details and then steal all the money out of my bank account. So we have a way of getting around this, which involves encrypting the communications so that I can communicate securely with Amazon, but it's very difficult for anyone who's listening into the communications to be able to work out what it is that I'm actually saying, and therefore it's very difficult for them to get my credit card details. So how do we go about encrypting numbers? Well, computers work on a binary system, so everything is written as ones and zeros, which means that you can think about the computer always communicating in whole numbers. And these cryptographic systems encode your credit card details as a whole number, and the way they then encrypt this whole number is that it involves multiplying and adding lots of these numbers together. And because it involves multiplying numbers together, this is a question about whole numbers and multiplication. And so we might expect that we could say something about this problem if we can understand the atoms of multiplication, which is the prime numbers. So in one of the most common cryptographic systems, it turns out that when you go through all the details, you can hack the system pretty efficiently if you can turn a large whole number into its prime factors. And conversely, if you want your credit card details to be secure, you better hope that it's therefore difficult to turn a large number into its prime factors. So for example, you could take the number 449,623 and ask what its prime factors. So I'll give chat a couple of seconds, but maybe it's not too easy to see what the prime factors are for this number, but it would certainly not take your computer too long to factorize this number. And it turns out that 449,623 is 521 times 863, and 521 and 863 are both prime numbers. So this is the prime factorization of 449,623. So if we're imagining it as a chemical compound, it would just be two atoms joined together. So I said it would be very quick for your computer to factorize this number, but as the numbers get larger and larger, it becomes much, much harder for your computer to factorize these numbers. So let's take a second example, which is a rather bigger number. I'm not going to read it all out. So this is certainly a lot bigger number, but it's very easy for your computer to deal with numbers of this size. It can multiply them together, it can add them, it can divide them, and it does that essentially instantly. But it's very difficult for your computer to factorize this number. And in fact, this number wasn't chosen randomly. There are various challenge numbers which test our ability of computers and computer algorithms to factor numbers, and you would win $75,000 if you're able to factor this. In principle, these days, I think it should be the case that you could buy out a huge amount of server time on Amazon or Google servers and maybe let it run for 6 months, and you would be able to factor this, but it would probably cost you about $1 million worth of computer time for the computers to actually come up with an answer there. So not worth it for winning $75,000, and that would be involving millions and millions of computers for months and months on end trying to factorize this, because it's that difficult a problem and we don't have a good way of turning a fairly large number into its prime factors. So this whole internet security cryptographic system relies on the security of it being difficult to just take a whole number and to turn it in and to write down what its prime factors are. But this means we can sort of theoretically investigate this problem a little bit more. And it's a fact, due to Pollard, that even if you have a very large number, like the number I had on the last slide, if one of its prime factors, let's call that prime factor P, has the property that P minus one itself only has very small prime factors, then there's a very quick algorithm that can factor the number. So this is really bad from an internet security point of view, because it means that if you're relying on some number being hard to factor, and it happens to have a prime factor P where P minus one only has small prime factors, then it will be very easy for a hacker to get your credit card details. So for example, you could take the prime number 2 × 3 × 4 × 5 × 320 and then add on one. It turns out this is a prime number. And I chose this one because this means that P minus one only has prime factors which are 300, which are all smaller than 320. So it all has, just has lots and lots of small prime factors. So this prime is much bigger than the number I put on the previous slide. But despite that, if you're looking for a multiple of that prime, I can factor, your computer can essentially factor any large multiple of this almost instantly using this Pollard trick, even though this is much, much larger than the $75,000 number. Of course, unfortunately, you don't get $75,000 for factoring this number. And this is an example, again, of we have a question involving whole numbers and prime numbers. And by using the fact that prime numbers are somehow the building blocks, we can find out that there's ways that we can efficiently turn a number into its factors, at least if there's some properties to do with prime numbers that exist. So once you've seen this factor of Pollard, you might be a bit concerned about your Amazon purchases. And so a natural question is, how often is it the case that I might have a prime factor where P minus one only has lots of small prime factors? If this happens all the time, then it would be the case that most of the time a hacker could crack your credit card details very easily and the whole of internet security would collapse. And this whole cryptographic algorithm would be completely insecure. So it turns out that we know theoretically that it is a rare occurrence that P minus one might have only lots and lots of small prime factors. And so we believe, therefore, that this shouldn't cause too much concern about you buying something online on Amazon. However, some people were certainly pretty concerned by this. And so one thing that was suggested was to only use so-called safe primes, which are about as far away from P minus one only having small prime factors as possible. So any prime bigger than two has to be odd. So P minus one is certainly going to be a multiple of two. So the furthest you could be away from having lots and lots of small prime factors would be a P minus one over two itself is a prime number. And these are so-called safe primes. And this is some of the documentation for one internet security algorithm. And you can choose to generate safe primes where the computer, when it's doing this encryption process, will only find numbers n where the prime factors all have the property that p minus 1 divided by 2 is also a prime number. So this is actually used in practice in some circumstances. But the interesting thing about this is that it quickly leads us on to a totally theoretical question about prime numbers, which has stumped mathematicians for hundreds of years, and we don't know the answer to. And it's this very simple question: how many prime numbers are there with this property that P minus one divided by two is a prime number? it would be really bad from the point of view of internet security if there were essentially none of these primes, if this was a very rare thing, because then your cryptographic scheme that's trying to encode your credit card details would just get stuck. It wouldn't be able to find a number with the right properties. And in fact, it would be even worse if there was just some very short list of primes that have a property that p minus 1 over 2 is a prime number, because then a hacker would just need to look up this list and try each one of these as possible prime factors, and they would be able to hack your credit card details very quickly. So whether this cryptographic scheme is an effective cryptographic scheme or not depends on the answer to this question: how many primes are there with, how many primes p are there with p minus 1 divided by 2 also a prime number? But this question is completely open to mathematicians. We don't have any good theoretical understanding of the problem. We don't know if there's infinitely, we believe that there should be infinitely many primes p such that p minus 1 divided by 2 is also a prime, but we don't know this at all, and so it could just be that there's some finite list of them. And if there was just a finite list, then it would certainly completely destroy cryptographic algorithms. So this is just one instance of a question that has been open in pure mathematics for over 100 years. It massively predates the rise of computers and the internet. So certainly it would have never, no one would have predicted that this question that interested pure mathematicians back in the Victorian times turned out to be fundamentally related to a cryptographic algorithm that we use day to day now in the 2000s. But the other crazy thing is that this problem is completely open, and we can boil this whole question down to something about prime numbers, but we don't know what the answer is. And many of the best mathematicians have looked at precisely this problem, and they've been completely stumped by it. Just the question as to whether there's only finitely many or whether there's infinitely many primes p such that p minus 1 over 2 is a prime number. Okay, so that was one example of a application of prime numbers in the real world. We looked at internet cryptography. We saw that it involved whole numbers being multiplied together because computers have to work in binary, and so essentially with whole numbers or something like whole numbers. And because it was whole numbers multiplied together, we were able to reduce our understanding of a cryptographic algorithm to certain very basic questions about prime numbers, because they're the building blocks of whole numbers under multiplication. I now want to move to the opposite extreme and show you an example as to how prime numbers crop up just within pure mathematics. So maybe the most famous equation in the whole of pure mathematics is Fermat's last theorem. So this was famously proved by Andrew Wiles just over 20 years ago. And this says that there are no solutions to the equation a to the power n plus b to the power n equals c to the power n in whole numbers a, b, c, and n whenever n is bigger than 2, apart from the obvious ones when one of a, b, or c is equal to 0. So this is saying if you take any number a, you multiply it by itself n times, you add it to b multiplied by itself n times, this can never equal c multiplied to itself n times for any choice of whole numbers a, b, c, and n, where n is bigger than 2, and you're not allowed to cheat and say a equals 0 and b equals c. So this is a picture of Fermat, who conjectured that this should be the case over 300 years ago. He famously claimed that he had a way of showing this, but there wasn't enough space in the margin of his book to prove it. But mathematicians then tried to prove this, and They tried for over 300 years, completely failed until Andrew Wiles finally made this breakthrough, developing a huge amount of modern mathematics and bringing it all together to solve this very pure question. So this is maybe the most famous question in the whole of pure mathematics, and it has one of the most complicated proofs in the whole of mathematics. But there's one very simple observation that's absolutely fundamental to the whole of Andrew Wiles's approach, which is to first reduce the whole problem to do with whole numbers down to a question about prime numbers. Because again, this is a question about whole numbers and it involves whole numbers being multiplied together. So the important observation, which is maybe the first step in Andrew Wiles's proof, is that it's enough to prove Fermat's last theorem when n is a prime number. So I just want to show how that might happen by recalling a few properties of exponentiation that you might have seen in school. So let's imagine that Fermat's last theorem is not true. So we're going to do this slightly bizarre thing that pure mathematicians like to do quite a lot, which is to argue by contradiction. You imagine the opposite of what you want to show, and then you reach some logical contradiction, which means that it must be the case that your initial assumption was wrong, and therefore what you want to show is in fact true. So imagine that Fermat's last theorem was false, and let's just take the special case when we're thinking of the exponent n being 15. So this means that imagine there are some whole numbers a, b, and c such that a times itself 15 times plus b times itself 15 times equals c times itself 15 times. Well, if you do a times a times a times a 15 times, that's the same as multiplying a by itself 5 times and then multiplying that number by itself 3 times. They both have 15 copies of a all multiplied together. So mathematically, we might write this as a to the power 15 is a to the power 5 to the power 3. But this means that if we had some magical numbers a, b, and c such that a to the power 15 plus b to the power 15 is equal to c to the power 15, then we would also have the fact that a to the power 5 to the power 3 plus b to the power 5 to the power 3 would equal c to the power 5 to the power 3, which would mean that we would also have a counterexample when instead of the exponent being 15, the exponent is 3, because we have the numbers a to the power 5, b to the power 5, and c to the power 5. And if you follow this argument through, what we saw here was that if there's a counterexample for any number n, then we automatically get a counterexample for any prime factor of n, which means that if there were no counterexamples whenever n is a, whenever you have an exponent of a prime number, you could never have any counterexample for any whole number n, because any whole number n would produce a counterexample for a prime number n, and we know no such ones exist. And so therefore, we only need to consider the exponent n in Fermat's last theorem to be a prime number. If you're paying lots of attention, we have to be slightly careful, because of course there are solutions when n is equal to 2, with a squared plus b squared equals c squared being of course the Pythagorean equation. And so you have to be a little bit careful for when n is some power of 2 for this argument, but actually Fermat already had proved that there were no solutions when n equals 4, which then means that we really do just need to consider n being a prime number. And so again, we've taken some question about whole numbers involving multiplication, and we've reduced it down to a question involving prime numbers. And this reduction is in fact exceptionally important for the whole of Andrew Wiles's argument, and it wouldn't work unless you had made this initial reduction. So there's not quite enough space on this slide for me to give the full proof of Fermat's last theorem, but this is the important initial reduction down to prime numbers, and it reduces the whole of Fermat's last theorem down more to a question about the distribution of prime numbers. So Wiles's work is an absolute pinnacle of modern mathematics. It's really an absolute cornerstone of the whole field, but there was a huge amount of partial progress that was done before Andrew Wiles's work. And so in this sense, I want to highlight the work of Sophie Germain, who was working on Fermat's last theorem in the 1820s. And she proved a fairly remarkable theorem. So she was the first one who managed to really get some way of handling Fermat's last theorem for general exponents n. So remember, we only need to consider n being a prime number. She was well aware of that. And she showed that if p is a prime number such that 2p plus 1 is also a prime number, then essentially there's no solutions to a to the power p plus b to the power p equals c to the power p. So there's no solutions to Fermat's last theorem with exponent p. She actually only showed that there were no solutions to the so-called first case of Fermat's last theorem, which is when a times b times c is not a multiple of p itself. But people morally thought that this was the most important case to deal with first. So if it was the case that for every prime p, 2p plus 1 was a prime number, then Sophie Germain would have essentially solved Fermat's last theorem. And she would have solved Fermat's last theorem for exponent p whenever 2p plus 1 is essentially prime. So an actual question when you see Sophie Germain's theorem is, okay, so how many exponents does this deal with? Or another way of saying that is, how many primes are there such that 2p plus 1 is also a prime number? So the Sophie Germain's theorem applies. And if you think back to my previous question from the cryptographic schemes, that question about prime numbers was, how many primes are there such that p minus 1 divided by 2 was a prime number? Because we were looking for safe primes. And you might realize that these are just exactly the same question in disguise. That if there are infinitely many primes p such that 2p plus 1 is prime, then just by swapping the two primes around, you see that there's infinitely many primes p such that p minus 1 over 2 is also a prime number. So again, we don't know the answer to this question. We don't know whether there's infinitely many primes p such that 2p plus 1 is a prime, and we don't know whether there's finitely many. But it turns out that this question, totally in pure mathematics, naturally leads us to a question purely about prime numbers that turns out to be exactly the same question about prime numbers as we saw in our real-world cryptographic example. And so this is the sort of remarkable features of prime numbers, that there's a huge number of different questions you can have to do with whole numbers being multiplied together. In general, these are very difficult, but we might hope to reduce them down to questions about the building blocks and the distribution of primes or patterns in the prime numbers. Questions like, how many primes are there such that 2p plus 1 is a prime number? And it turns out that completely different problems from completely different worlds all reduce down often to these very simple questions about patterns in the prime numbers. And if we had a good understanding for patterns in prime numbers, we might hope to have a general toolkit that could solve a huge number of different problems to do with whole numbers that crop up across pure mathematics, but also in the real world. So that would be the dream, to have some good understanding of the prime numbers, where we have some good general theory about the distribution of prime numbers. And so these are the kind of fundamental questions that I like to spend my time thinking about. I'm not an expert on cryptographic systems, and I don't work particularly on equations like Fermat's last theorem. I try and think about new ways of proving properties to do with the distribution of prime numbers, like the question that has cropped up in both of those two examples. So We've already seen two questions about prime numbers that have come up. How many primes P are there, such that P minus one only has small prime factors? I said we do have some reasonable theoretical understanding on this problem, although not perfect. And fortunately, we are able to show that these potential primes that would scupper a cryptographic system are pretty rare. But this other question, which is the same as the Sophie Germain question about how many primes P are there with P minus one over two, a prime number, is a famous problem that has been open for over 100 years. And these are such basic questions to do with these fundamental objects that I just find these absolutely fascinating questions in and of themselves. So I'd like to give a few other examples of problems where we still don't know the answer, despite them being some of the most basic questions you could possibly ask about prime numbers. So maybe I mentioned this before, the question of how many prime numbers are there less than some large number X? So imagine you're not allowed to use a computer to try and go through all the numbers up to X to work out how many primes there are. Is there some quick way that you can tell roughly how many primes there are? Well, one of the most celebrated results in mathematics proved about 100 years ago is the so-called prime number theorem that gives a very rough answer to this. And I've already mentioned that the Riemann hypothesis, maybe the most important problem in mathematics, would give a very precise answer to this. And that has a $1 million reward. Another example of a very basic question that I like to think about and I've spent quite a lot of time working on to do with patterns in the distribution of primes is how close can prime numbers be to one another? So we know that apart from two, all prime numbers are odd because they can't have two as a factor, which means that if you take two prime numbers, they have to differ by at least two unless they're the prime numbers two and three. And the twin prime conjecture is the question as to whether there's infinitely many prime numbers such that p plus two is a prime number. So infinitely many pairs of primes that differ by exactly two. We believe there should be infinitely many of these couples of primes that come as close as possible together. So like three and five, or five and seven, or 11 and 13, these are pairs of prime numbers that differ by exactly two. But like this question of Sophie Germain, we don't know whether there's infinitely many or not. And this is still an open problem that's been studied for hundreds of years, and we don't know the answer to it. So it's almost embarrassing for a mathematician like me who spends my time thinking about questions about prime numbers that we don't know the answers to some of these basic questions. And we're still so ignorant despite so much effort about the primes. However, I don't want to end on a negative note, so I'd like to end on a positive note, which means that despite there being these absolutely fundamental questions about these basic building blocks that we don't really understand, we are able to make progress. So for example, one result that I was involved in recently is a weak version of the twin prime conjecture. So the twin prime conjecture is the claim that there's infinitely many pairs of primes that differ by at most two. Unfortunately, we can't quite show this, but we can show that there's infinitely many pairs of primes that differ by no more than 246. So this might sound like a strange thing, but because we're dealing with infinity here, 246 is actually a remarkably small number. And just 10 years ago, there was no such bound was known. We weren't able to prove anything like there are infinitely many pairs of primes that differ by no more than a billion. That would have been viewed as a result that was completely out of reach of modern mathematics, but by developing new ideas, new techniques, we're able to produce such a bound and we can get down to 246. So this is getting us in some ways quite close to the twin prime conjecture itself. The twin prime, we've got from infinity down to 246. We just need to get further from 246 down to two. Similarly, using very closely related ideas, there was this question that I mentioned about cryptographic algorithms and cryptographic schemes. There was also this connected to Sophie Germain's work on Fermat's Last Theorem, which was asking, are there infinitely many primes P such that P minus 1 over 2 is a prime number? And we can't quite show that with the numbers 1 and 2, but we can show some very closely related things such that we can show that there are fixed numbers A1 and A2 such that there are infinitely many primes P with P minus A1 divided by A2 a prime number. So if we could do this with A1 equals 1 and A2 equals 2, then we would have answered this question related to cryptographic systems and related to Fermat's Last Theorem. We can't quite do that, but somehow this is a near miss, and this gives us a lot of confidence that our guesses to lots of these answers are on the right track. So it doesn't have any direct implications for cryptography, for example, other than some of the heuristics that cryptographers have to rely on are maybe boosted a bit, and they're able to sleep slightly better at night when theoretical mathematics is able to make some partial progress that's consistent with what we believe to be true. So I'm basically out of time. I'll just recap here. There are many important and interesting questions involving whole numbers that appear across mathematics and outside of mathematics. Whenever they involve multiplication, you can often break these complicated questions to do with whole numbers that we don't have any good toolkits for into questions just about the prime numbers, because the prime numbers are somehow these fundamental building blocks. And if we had a perfect understanding of the distribution of prime numbers, this might mean that we could solve our original problem to do with these questions about whole numbers. But unfortunately, many of the most basic questions to do with the distribution of prime numbers are these famous unsolved problems in mathematics that mathematicians have tried and failed to solve for hundreds of years. But despite us being stuck for hundreds of years, we are slowly making progress, and maths is very much alive, and we're getting ever closer to proving these famous unresolved problems about the distribution of prime numbers, which we might hope one day will give us a general toolkit for understanding these important and interesting questions involving whole numbers and multiplication. So thanks a lot for listening. I think I'll stop here and pass over for questions.
Okay, great, thank you very much. I'll do the round of applause, and people can add their own reactions. There are some which people should be able to see. We're getting thumbs up and all sorts going on there. So so if people would like to put some questions in the chat, and we can perhaps I can start going through and answering some questions. Just to kick things off, one of the things you mentioned at the end was the twin primes on that bound that you were talking about. That's down to 246, I think you said.
Yeah.
It seemed as though there was rapid progress going on, and there was a whole lot of exciting stuff coming out every sort of really quickly. Things have obviously slowed down. Is that because we've now hit a wall, or are people still working on this and it's some of the techniques are being used elsewhere? Is that what's happening?
Yeah. So this is often how I guess mathematical progress happens. Initially, there were a couple of different, really new insights that allowed us to prove some of these results. And so when these new ideas come along, everyone gets very excited. We try and work out exactly how far these limits can be pushed, and to try and, it's always the new ideas that underlie it that are somehow the most exciting thing for mathematicians. So when it first came out, there's all this excitement. People were refining these ideas to kind of squeeze every last bit out of it. We now feel like we've hit a bit of a wall on that original problem about gaps between primes. It now needs a new kind of theoretical breakthrough to really get big progress. But the underlying ideas are still being kind of understood more generally by the field. And so they're finding applications to various other slightly more technical questions about prime numbers that crop up. So it's one of these strange things that often as a mathematician, I might be very excited by a result, but if someone proves the Riemann hypothesis, I'll be less excited by the fact that the room hypothesis is proven, and much more excited by the fact that they've come up with some idea that's allowed them to prove the room hypothesis, because then I can start thinking about all the other problems that might be solved by using this idea in other contexts. And so that's very much been happening here. Maybe the direct applications have slowed down a bit, but people are still finding other applications and using these ideas in more surprising contexts.
Okay, thanks. So I'll start looking at some of the questions. I'll try and pick some at random, as it were. So there's one that I think a number of people would like to know. So if the Riemann hypothesis is shown to be true, what exactly does that mean about the distribution of the primes? That to a bigger question on the.
Okay, so there was this quote that I mentioned by Zagier that the primes, on the one hand, are totally deterministic. They just have this dry definition. But on the other hand, they seem to obey no law whatsoever. And the Riemann hypothesis would sort of give a partial explanation as to why this phenomenon seems to occur, that on the one hand, they have very clearly defined statistical behavior like random objects do, but on a small scale, we can't understand them at all. And that's because the distribution of the primes would be governed by so-called special zeros of a function called the Riemann zeta function. So there's just some magical function, and whenever an input gives zero, that is a constant that is very important to do with the distribution of prime numbers. So Marcus de Sautoy calls this the music of the primes, and the Riemann hypothesis is roughly saying that all of these constants kind of all produce sort of notes or frequencies that affect the distribution of the primes at a similar volume, that means that they kind of almost cancel each other out like noise, which is why the primes look random, and they have this strong statistical behavior on a large scale, but are very difficult to understand on a small scale. So it would give a very precise guess as to the number of primes less than some given number, but because it would sort of be saying that even though they are rigid, they really are behaving like random numbers, it wouldn't have any important applications to cryptography and things that I'm aware of. So the Riemann hypothesis itself has lots of theoretical applications for the distribution of primes, but it wouldn't have any particular implications for cryptography, so you wouldn't need to worry about your Amazon purchases, unless, again, the idea behind the proof gave such an insight into prime numbers that it would give a completely new toolkit for looking at these cryptographic questions.
Right, indeed. Yeah, yeah. You never quite know what's going to come out of the method. Yeah. I'll ask another question. It's from Dishant. It says, what can we say about triples of primes? Is there any are any results proved or conjectured in case of triples, like the twin prime conjecture?
Yeah, exactly. So that's a great question. And yeah, there are questions about triples and how close can primes come together. So there's it can get a little bit more tricky, because you might hope that you could have infinite primes P such that P plus 2 and P plus 4 are both prime numbers. But actually that's impossible, because one of P plus 2 or P plus 4 must be a multiple of 3, because they all leave a different remainder after division by 3. And therefore one of them must be a multiple of 3, and so they can't all be prime numbers, because we know that all prime numbers bigger than 3 aren't a multiple of 3. However, we do believe that there should be infinitely many prime numbers P such that P plus 2 and P plus 6 are both prime numbers. And so this will give us triples of prime numbers all contained in an interval of length 6. So that's like a triples version of the twin prime conjecture. And just as we were able to show that there's infinitely many pairs of primes that differ by no more than 246, we're able to show that there's some fixed finite number such that there's infinitely many primes p such that you get triples within an interval of that fixed length. I can't remember exactly what the number is now. It's something like a billion. It gets a lot worse, but you can show that there's infinitely many intervals of length, maybe a billion, that contain three primes. And in fact, you can extend this. So we can show that you can look for quadruples or quintuples of primes all contain all very close to one another. And you can show that regardless of how many primes you're looking for, if you look at big enough finite length intervals, you can find infinitely many of these finite length intervals that contain, say, a million primes, even though normally you'd expect there to be no primes in such an interval. So you get these rare clusters of primes very close together. And it's very much like what we had before, that you have to be a bit careful, but once you're careful about being a multiple of three or multiple of five and things, we have some strong conjectures as to how often we think these things should occur. We can't quite prove that, but we can prove weaker versions where we get these unusually dense clusters of many primes together. But good question.
Right, okay. Good. So maybe as time's getting on, I'll ask one more question. I don't know if this one's getting a bit too technical though. But can values of A1 and A2 with the P1 minus A1 over A2 prime infinitely often be given explicitly? Or do we just know that that A1 and A2 exist?
Okay, that's a great question. And yeah, we only know that they exist. So again, you could say that maybe A1 and A2, which are both between 0 and 100. But I can't give you any explicit choice of A1 and A2. We just know that they exist, and it's one out of a finite list of things. But I can't give you any explicit A1 and A2. And this is somehow a fundamental kind of obstacle in our method.
Yeah, in all sorts of methods like this, it's very hard to give explicit formulae, not like Pythagorean triples, right? I mean, that's like the most basic thing which works very, very well. Right. Okay, I think that's where we should perhaps leave it. It's now 20 past. So I'd just like to thank everybody for coming and asking your questions. And most of all, I'd like to thank our two speakers tonight, James and Aoife. So if perhaps we could give them another round of applause and some reactions so that we can share our appreciation for them. So as I say, thank you all very much for coming. And good night.
Thanks everyone for coming along.